to the worship theology.
Friends, let me say good morning and welcome again to worship here at St. Andrew's United Methodist Church in Charlotte. Just want to begin our time together, as always, with a few needed updates. First, concerning worship. Due to lingering COVID-19 concerns and the extension through December 4th of Phase 3 with additional limitations, we are grateful, and I do mean we are grateful, that we can gather online this Sunday, as well as for the next two. So November 22nd and November 29th will be online only also. It is our hope that we will be able to gather in person on December 6th and December 13th, and that we will be in our sanctuary on Christmas Eve. But friends, all of that is dependent upon what the virus and our response to it brings. We promise to continue to update everyone as quickly as we're able, and the best way to get information is through the church's website, chatter, and Facebook page. We also encourage you to reach out to our leadership, both lay and staff, and providing your input as we chart a course that keeps everyone safe and moves us forward. We also want to remind you that there are continuing ways for us to be church, to reach out and to engage in missions. First of all, thank you to everyone who participated in Operation Christmas Child this year. And I trust that Larry and Linda Collins will give us an update soon on the overall progress of that program. We also encourage you this year to wish your friends and neighbors a Merry Christmas through the St. Andrew's United Methodist Church annual alternative gift-giving Christmas card. I'm really excited about ways that the card offers insight into our sisters and partners' ministries and outreach, and the cover was designed by our very own Patty Huss this year. I know that you won't want to miss this, and cards are available when we gather in person, but also available anytime. Just stop by when the church office is open, or you can call the church office and we can even send some to you. Thank you in advance for that care. And as Thanksgiving approaches, I do want to lift up Loaves and Fishes. For a gift of $25, you can provide a nutritionally balanced meal for 108 meals during this season. So thank you in advance for your attention to all of that. I want to wish our Marine Corps a happy 245th birthday this past Tuesday, and offer a special thanks to all of our military veterans, and I would add those currently serving and their families, as we recognize Veterans Day on Wednesday, November 11th. As a military daughter and mom, I simply say thank you for your service. And last but not least, concerning financial support, as I said last week, I'll keep it short. Please and thank you. As we approach the end of 2020, it has been a trying season, but it has also been an opportunity for new ways of engaging, new opportunities to be church, and we thank you for your faithful support of that mission and ministry. So friends, again, thank you for choosing to worship with us this morning. Let us continue to worship God in spirit and in truth.
Thank you.
Friends, our call to worship is this, taken from the Book of Worship back from 1965. Praise be to God. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, who has visited and redeemed his people. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed this day and each day be the name of the Lord.
I am drenched in love. All sins atoned by the blood of the Lamb. I'm not a slave to what once held me dead. How beautiful that ends in blood. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched.
I am drenched in love.
Singing, oh, praise.
Miss Pat. May the peace of Christ be with you.
Miss Sherri, may the peace of Christ be with you.
May the peace of Christ be with you and also with you.
Hey, you guys, I want to show you something new I got. I've got this. Do you know what this is? It comes out, has numbers. It's a tape measure. So exciting, because you know what I get to do with this? It's so much fun. I can measure how big our altar table is. Cool. It is 7 feet. Oh, wait, I have an idea. How tall is our candle? All the candles are 2 foot 3 inches. Those are pretty tall. What else? Oh, can I measure the cornucopia up here? Let's see how big it is. Whoa, it's 2 foot long. It has so much in it. I know. How tall is our pumpkin? The pumpkin is 7 inches tall. There's so many things you can do with this, and there's so many things we can measure. I have an idea. I wonder if I spread it out really far, if I can find out how far away God is from me. You think that's gonna work? Let me look. Well, that didn't work. I wonder why it didn't work. Do you have any ideas? I know. Maybe we can go all the way up. Let's see if I can go up to see how far away God is from me. Why does it keep doing that? Well, get it. I'm trying, and it comes right back, and then it goes in back together. But I want to see where God is and how far away he is from me, and maybe how big God is. Oh, wait. You know, I think I learned something about this. God's not far away. He's right here. I don't have to measure to see where he is, because he's everywhere around me all the time. I don't need to see how big God is, because he's so big, it's unimaginable. He's everywhere all the time, and his love is so grand, it exists in the world around me. It exists in the wonderful bounty of food that we're given. It exists in the wonderful trees outside that will bloom in the spring and have leaves that come out, and these gorgeous colors in the fall when they fall to the ground. God's there. He's in it. It's his creation. He's in the air around me that I breathe. He's with me at all times. And I want you guys to remember that. When you look around, know that God is everywhere. And he is huge, and he's in everything that you do. Let's have a prayer together. Thank you, God, for this beautiful sanctuary where we can come and worship you. Thank you, God, for the whole earth. So when I look around, I can see you in everything. Thank you, God, for being everywhere and loving me every day. Amen. See you later, guys.
Dear friends, queridos amigos, let's pray. Vamos a orar. God of power and victory, we praise you because you reign over all things created by you. Dios de poder y victoria, te alabamos porque reinas sobre todas las cosas creadas por ti. Your purpose fills the universe and makes us contemplate your wonders. Tu propósito llena el universo y nos hace contemplar tus maravillas. Your ways are perfect compared to ours and we submit to your designs. Tus caminos son perfectos comparado a los nuestros y nos sometemos a tus designios. We pray for the St. Andrews family, for all members and leaders, and for the mission we face in the community. Oramos por la familia de St. Andrews, sus miembros y líderes, y por la misión que tenemos en esta comunidad. We pray for all people who suffer from diseases of all kinds, those who are in hospitals, in rehabilitation homes, and those who depend on special medications. May your healing hand be upon them. Oramos por las personas que sufren enfermedades de toda índole, los que están en los hospitales, en casas de rehabilitación y los que dependen de medicación especial. Que tu mano sanadora esté sobre ellos. We pray for those who lost their loved ones, that spiritual comfort encamp over them in abundant peace and grace. Oramos por aquellos que perdieron a sus entes queridos. Que el consuelo espiritual acampe sobre ellos en abundante paz y gracia. Thank you for all the families and individuals who stay connected in online services, where we see each other and strengthen our faith and fellowship with one another. Gracias por las familias e individuales que se mantienen conectados en los servicios online, donde nos vemos y fortalecemos nuestra fe y comunión unos con otros. Thank you for all the outreach ministries St. Andrews does with the toddlers, teens, and youth of the community. Gracias por los ministerios de alcance de St. Andrews que realiza junto a los infantes, adolescentes, y jóvenes de la comunidad. During these past days, we have disconcentrated from your desires, taking care of the attractions of our world. Durante estos últimos días, nos hemos desconcentrado de tus deseos, ocupándonos de las atracciones de nuestro mundo. Perdónanos, Señor. Forgive us, O Lord. We pray for all the newly elected and re-elected representatives of our country. Oramos por todos los recién electos y reelectos a los cargos representativos de nuestro país. Although the chosen ones may not be the one of our preference, we pray that they be honest, the things needed to be done. Aunque los elegidos no sean de nuestra preferencia, rogamos para que sean honestos en las cosas que deben realizar. As we prepare to celebrate Thanksgiving in a few weeks, we pray for our hearts will be filled with joy and gratitude. Mientras nos preparamos para celebrar nuestra acción de gracias en pocas semanas, rogamos para que nuestros corazones se llenen de alegría y gratitud. In the midst of so much information trapped us, help us keep our eyes on you, knowing that you are supremely in charge of everything. En medio de tanta información que nos atrapan, ayúdanos a mantener nuestros ojos en ti, sabiendo que estás supremamente a cargo de todo. And now, we exalt your holy name with joy and devotion as we remember the prayer that you taught to your disciples. Y ahora exaltamos tu santo nombre con alegría y devoción al recordar la oración que enseñaste a tus discípulos, diciendo, saying together, Padre nuestro que estás en el cielo, santificado sea tu nombre, venga tu reino, hágase tu voluntad como en el cielo así también en la tierra. El pan nuestro de cada día dánoslo hoy, perdona nuestras deudas como también perdonamos a nuestros deudores. Y no nos dejes caer en tentación, sino líbranos del mal, porque tuyo es el reino, el poder y la gloria por todos los siglos. Amén.
Today's scripture lesson is found in the book of Malachi, chapter 3, verses 1 through 4, according to the New Living Translation. We read the word of God in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Look, I am sending my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. Then the Lord you are seeking will suddenly come to his temple, the messenger of the covenant, whom you look for so eagerly. Is surely coming, says the Lord of heaven's armies. But who will be able to endure it when he comes? Who will be able to stand and face him when he appears? For he will be like a blazing fire that refines metal, or like a strong soap that bleaches clothes. He will sit like a refiner of silver, burning away the dross. He will purify the Levites, refining them like gold and silver, so that they may once again offer acceptable sacrifices to the Lord. Then once more, the Lord will accept the offerings brought to him by the people of Judah and Jerusalem, as he did in the past. La lección de la escritura de hoy se encuentra en el libro de Malaquías, capítulo 3, versículos 1 al 4. Según la nueva traducción viviente, la palabra de Dios se lee en el nombre del Padre, del Hijo y del Espíritu Santo. Miren, yo envío a mi mensajero y él preparará el camino delante de mí. Entonces el Señor al que ustedes buscan vendrá de repente a su templo. El mensajero del pacto a quien buscan con tanto entusiasmo, sin duda vendrá, dice el Señor de los ejércitos celestiales. Pero, ¿qué será capaz de soportar su venida? ¿Quién podrá mantenerse de pie y estar cara a cara con él cuando aparezca? Pues él será como un fuego abrasador que refina el metal o como un jabón fuerte que blanquea la ropa. Se sentará como un refinador de plata y quemará la escoria, purificará a los levitas, refinándolos como en el oro y la plata, para que vuelvan a ofrecer sacrificios aceptables al Señor. Nuevamente el Señor recibirá las ofrendas que el pueblo de Judá y Jerusalén le llevan como lo hizo en el pasado. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Esta es la palabra de Dios para el pueblo de Dios. Gracias, Señor.
Friends, today we are exploring the Old Testament prophet Malachi. It is the last of the Old Testament prophets, both in biblical placement and chronologically. Last week, we talked about the end of the story, a peek at the ending offered by Zechariah. And you may think that Malachi, being the end of the Old Testament story, would offer a happily ever after, or at least a solid we made it conclusion. But alas, that is not quite true. Malachi was written in a time of unsettlement. The Hebrew children, under the order of Cyrus, the king of Persia, had been allowed to return home. Yay for homecomings! But I'm also mindful as I read Malachi's work, the phrase, "You can't go home again," also comes to mind. The great exile had switched direction, and the great return migration was in place. The people had been home for about 60 years. And Harnish writes, once the people were excited about their faith. When Yahweh brought them back from exile, they anticipated great things. Certainly, the prophetic promises would be fulfilled. They would recover the halcyon days of King David. The land, miraculously fruitful. All the nations of the earth would come to worship in Jerusalem. And the vision, the hope, that had kept them going through those years of exile would finally be fulfilled. But as they were home, and as the years passed, things didn't turn out the way that they expected. Israel was an insignificant speck in the vast Persian Empire and was ruled by a Persian governor. The land was rocky and unproductive. The economy was in shambles. The temple had been rebuilt, but worship was a lethargic, careless habit. The offerings were cheap and tawdry. Even the priests ignored the Lord. Deep apathy, weary indifference, and bland skepticism had settled over the people. Over the long haul, their high optimism had worn thin. What Malachi encountered and sought to counter was in part a case of spiritual exhaustion or disillusionment. Harnish writes, when visions are shattered, when the promise goes unfulfilled, even the most faithful of people will ask with the people of Jerusalem, where is the God of love? Where is God's justice? What is the use in trying anymore? Where is God's love? It's a poignant question. And in response to that question, I would suspect that we could recite verses by heart that speak to God's love of us. Consider John 3:16. You can say that with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Or 1 John 4:19. We love because he first, God first, loved us. Even in the Old Testament, consider these words from Deuteronomy 7. The Lord did not set his heart on you, speaking to Israel, and choose you because you were more numerous than other nations, for you were the smallest of all nations. Rather, it was simply that the Lord loves you, and he was keeping the oath he had sworn to your ancestors. That is why the Lord rescued you with such a strong hand. But friends, the response to the question of where is the God of love is not so comforting in Malachi. Throughout Malachi, the prophet records the questions asked by the people related to God's presence and God's promises, and God's response through Malachi is to point the finger back at them. The people are focused on their dire circumstances, but unable to accept any accountability for the actions that have brought them there. They refuse to bear any responsibility for their own sins. And so God's response to their questions calls them to account for their misdeeds and shows them the results of their actions. Through Malachi, God tells the people where they have fallen short of their covenant with him. And the people are told that change will happen when they take responsibility for their actions and serve God faithfully according to the promise made by their ancestors. And to put an even finer point on it, consider today's lesson from the beginning of chapter 3. Malachi writes, "See, these are God's words. I am sending my messenger to prepare the way before me, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple, the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight. Indeed, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts." Sounds promising, right? But then Malachi continues, "But who can endure the day of his coming? And who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like fuller's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. And he will purify the descendants of Levi and refine them like gold and silver until they present offering to the Lord in righteousness. For he is like a refiner's fire and like fuller's soap." Now, friends, a fuller in biblical time was a launderer, and one can imagine the process by which clothing and robes of the day would have had to have been kept clean. The trade of the fullers appears to be consisted chiefly in cleansing garments and whitening them, and the process of fulling or cleansing clothes consisted in treading or stamping on the garments with feet or with baths in tubs of water, in which some alkaline substance answering the purpose of soap had been dissolved. And apparently, the chemicals used in this process were so potent, so, or for lack of a more delicate term, smelly, that the work had to be done outside of the city gates. Friends, as to the refiner's fire, now I will tell you, one of my favorite things to do at the state fair is to go to the old-time village. I've always admired craftsmen at work, carpenters and smiths, blacksmiths, silversmiths, glassblowers. Their craft is absolutely fascinating to me, taking raw materials and crafting them into tools, jewelry, or art. And the art of refining, the art of refining gold or silver is an interesting one. First, the raw material is broken and placed in a crucible. The crucible is a container often crafted of a lesser value, yet a more heat-resistant substance, such as iron. The ore containing the silver and gold is then placed into the fire, and as the ore is melted, dross rises. Now, dross consists of impurities that take away from the valuable metal that remains. And as the dross forms, the refiner carefully removes it, returning the crucible to the flame repeatedly for just the right time and just the right temperature. The refiner looks for progress by looking for their reflection on the surface. The more dross removed, the less distorted the reflection. And the skilled refiner is able to recognize when the process is complete because the reflection of the refiner is pure. I've also read, as was stated, the refiner must keep the heat at just the right point. Too much heat destroys the raw material in total. And it is a process that cannot be rushed and it cannot be left. A close eye on the material must be kept by the refiner.
Now, friends, there is a danger, I believe, a short, slippery slope or leap that can be made, that when we find ourselves in calamity, that God has placed us there. And let me state that my theology just doesn't let me go there.
I believe that we, like the return diaspora to which Malachi was speaking, often find ourselves in trouble, and often it's of our own stubborn making. It's a bit like the joke of the man, I know that you've heard this before, of there was heavy rains and floods were coming, and the policeman came and said, you had to go, and the man said, God will save me. And the waters rose, and the boat came by and invited him to come in, and the man said, no, God will save me. And the water rose some more, and he climbed to the roof of the house, and a boat came by, and a helicopter came by and said, you got to get in, and he said, no, God will save me. Sadly, the floodwaters rose. The man drowned, and when he got to the pearly gates, he said, Lord, what happened? And you know the punchline of this story. I know you've heard it before. The Lord looked at him and said, I sent policemen, a boat, and a helicopter. What more help did you want from me? Because see, I believe like the refiner, God does not abandon us to circumstance. I believe that even in the midst of the darkest calamity, that God is present. I have often said, you will hear me say, that God is as near to us as our very breath. And I say this based upon the story in Genesis when it says that God blew God's breath and animated Adam, animated us, animated dirt. That the Holy Spirit is described from everything from a gentle breeze to a whirlwind. And that Jesus is the Word, and that a living Word implies breath. Jesus brought breath into spaces for countless people. Consider the woman kept from stoning, or Lazarus brought forth from the tomb. Or consider these words from the psalmist. In Psalm 139, where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me, your right hand will hold me fast. But friends, God's unfailing presence does not negate the consequences of our actions. As I look into our world, the evidence of our failings abounds. It's a common theme throughout the prophets. Remember the words of Amos and Jonah and Nahum? As Yogi Berra said, Malachi's oracle compared with the other minor prophets is a bit like deja vu all over again. And like Malachi's congregants, the need for confession is lifted for us once again. Friends, consider this prayer. And this is from our brothers and sisters at the Presbyterian Church of the USA. Gracious God, our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, and too deep to undo. Forgive what our lips tremble to name, what our hearts can no longer bear, and what has become for us a consuming fire of judgment. Set us free from a past that we cannot change. Open to us a future in which we can be changed, and grant us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Amen and amen. And friends, maybe it is an act of confession, true confession with a bent toward repentance, that we begin that move towards hope. Maybe the work of the refiner's fire is to allow the people to see for themselves who they truly are. And it also allows them to see who they can become. The true reflection of who God has created them to be. As one commentator suggested, Malachi offers a stern ending, but there is also good news tucked away in this prophet. Dig for it, and you'll find it. Malachi begins his oracle with this, I have loved you, says the Lord, but you say, how have you loved us? And the answer for them and for us is ultimately found tucked away in the third chapter, verse 6, I think. It says, "For I, the Lord, do not change. Therefore, you, O children of Jacob, have not perished." Friends, somehow in God's good reason, he persists in granting us the gift of persisting. While we have not yet reached that happy ending, we remember that we have already had a peek at the last page, and we claim the solid foundation on which we stand, and that is the immutable and steadfast nature of God's unchanging mercy and grace. We know, we claim, that the righteousness of our world has already been accomplished through the work of God, through the gift of his Son, Jesus Christ, and through the power of the Holy Spirit. Yet God has deemed this work of transformation will be done in partnership between God and us. As the saying goes, faith can move mountains. But don't be surprised if God hands you a shovel. Confession, repentance, following Jesus' great commandment of loving God and loving neighbor. Harnish writes, if we want to experience a vibrant, energizing relationship with God, if we want to know the purifying, renewing love of God, we need to give. And I would suggest we need to move, to be moved, to respond, to pray, to ask for forgiveness, to forgive, to work for justice, for peace, to honor God in all that we say and do, to pour out ourselves with generous hearts. Friends, it's in this God's reflection in God's kingdom becomes ever clearer. For as Malachi offers in chapter 4, verse 2, "But for you who obey me, my saving power will rise on you like the sun and bring healing like the sun's rays. You will be as free and as happy as calves let out of a stall." So where is God's love? Harnish offers us these concluding thoughts. You can see it in the way God works for justice in the world. You can see it in the way God refines and purifies faithful followers. You will find when you learn to give. And then one day, the healing sun will rise on you, and with Malachi, you will know that God has always loved you and loves you still. That is our promise. That is our hope. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and all God's children said, Amen.
Let us pray. God of all blessings, source of all life, giver of all grace, we thank you for your presence in worship today, for your presence in our church, for your presence in our community, for your presence in our homes, and for your presence throughout this pandemic. We ask you to continue to guide and lead us. We pray for peace, comfort, and understanding. We ask for the strength to be patient, and we pray for the courage to be compassionate. We thank you for this day, for the gift of worship, for the gift of life, for the gift of community, and for the gift of your grace and forgiveness. For these and all your blessings, we give you thanks, O God. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Cold and
Friends, as we part from one another this day, our sending forth is actually taken from Richard Allen, an African Methodist Episcopal bishop in the 1800s. We believe, O Lord, that you have not abandoned us to the dim light of our own reason to conduct us to happiness, that you have revealed this day in the reading of your word. Whatever is necessary for us to believe and practice. How noble and excellent are your precepts, how sublime and enlightening the truth, how persuasive and strong the motives, how powerful the assistance of your holy religion. Our delight shall be your statutes, and we will not forget your word. Carry that word with you, my friends, this week and beyond. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and again, all those gathered said, Amen.